Well, hello, Woodman. We are still in Nashville, Tennessee, here at Proclamation Church, a church that we have this opportunity to come alongside and help see established as they look to launch publicly this coming January. Pastor Derek taught last weekend, and he's going to teach again. And it is a message that we really need to hear. There's so much unrest, there's so much anxiety, there's so much anger and turmoil. Everything, it seems, can be politicized now. And today, we hear of God's heart for justice, God's heart for us as we fight for justice. And we gather to love well, to see lives changed through Christ. And this, well, that's what this service is about. Let's worship.
Yeah. thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner, now I'm not. With your blood, you bought my freedom. Hallelujah. Sing out hallelujah, and we will cry out hallelujah, and all will sing out hallelujah, and we will cry out hallelujah. The poor and powerless, and all the lost and lonely, and all the thieves will come confess, and know that you are holy, and know that you are holy. And all will sing out hallelujah, and we will cry out hallelujah. And all the hearts who are content, and all who feel unworthy, and all who hurt with nothing left, will know that you are holy, and all will sing out from the mountains. Go on and tell it to the masses that He is God. Shout it. Go on and scream it from the mountains. The masses. shout it. Go on and scream it from the mountains. Go on and tell it to the masses that He is God.
Well, hello there, Woodman family. It is Pastor Derek again. I'm so excited to have another opportunity to open up the Word of God with you all this weekend. You know, I was thinking and processing about even how we've gotten to this point where I'm able to preach with you guys again. I just want to let you know that your Pastor Josh, he's amazing. I'm sure you guys feel that way and know that. And obviously in the midst of COVID and everything else, how he is trying to navigate and lead you guys in a way that is both pastoral and caring. You guys have an amazing leader. I don't know if you guys knew this or not, but my call to ministry was actually at Josh's church several years ago. And so that just shows, number one, how old he is, but at the same time, how great he is. And so we're thankful for him and his leadership and the fact that we have an opportunity now to be together because of that relationship. So if you have your Bibles, why don't you go ahead and turn to Amos chapter 5. That is where we're going to be. And as a way of reminder, I'm here in Nashville, Tennessee, and to kind of give you a little history of where our area, where we are and why we chose this specific spot in Nashville. There are a lot of places in Nashville, right? You've got the Gulch, you've got the Nations, you got East Nashville, you have Brentwood, Franklin, Woodbine. And the area where we are is closer to Woodbine. And we chose this area specifically because we wanted to see the gospel do some amazing things. We wanted to see the gospel redeem and transform. And not only that, we wanted to get to the conversation of race and justice and seeing people flourish here in this particular area of Nashville. And I say all that to say because as the people of God, we need to have a concern for human flourishing. And as we open up the book of Amos today, we are going to see why. Now, I just moved to Nashville about 2 months ago, and I have to tell you guys, hopefully this doesn't, you know, cause you to not want to move here with us or anything like that, but it rains a lot here in Nashville. When we first moved here, it rained for about a week and a half straight, I kid you not. And with one of those rainstorms, it was a thunderstorm. And I mean, we're talking about the loudest thundering and booming and everything else. And it reminded me of when I moved from New York down to North Carolina before moving here. So when I moved from from New York to North Carolina, I had to get used to the sound of trains. I never heard a train horn or anything like that. And we lived right next to a train depot. And what would happen as trains were coming in into the train depot, they had to cross this drive where cars were at. And so if you've ever been by a train or at a crossing or anything like that, when they're coming up to that, they are laying on the horn. They're pulling that thing down. And literally every hour there would be a train coming by our house and they would just blow on that horn and 5-year-old Derek would be scared out of his mind. I remember going to my grandmother in her room and crying and asking her what in the world is going on. And she told me, she was like, well, the trains are just letting people know that they're coming and so that they need to be careful. Well, we find ourselves in Amos chapter 5 right now, and God is blowing on that horn. He's pulling it down and he's saying, hey, something is coming. Something is coming towards the people of Israel. And God is using Amos to sound that alarm. Today, we're going to be looking at the heart of God and his desire for righteousness and justice. And when we seek after him, how that righteousness and justice should flow from us as well. Now, I'll go ahead and say, in our climate today, as we are coming up into a political season, it can be easy to be dismissive about what we're going to see and hear. And it's easy for us to just chalk this up to be a political agenda. However, the reality is what we're going to see today is not political in the least. It marks the heart of God. Now, if you're not familiar with the book of Amos, just to give you a refresher, Amos is a prophet heading up to speak to the king and the leadership of Israel. You see, Israel, they found themselves in a position where they're sitting pretty. They've had this history of slavery in Egypt, and now they've become this kingdom with a lineage of mighty kings like David and his wise son Solomon. And Israel is riding this wave of success. But however, in their success, their kingdom is split in two. You had Israel and you had Judah. Now, the nation of Israel in the north, they began to find themselves in a position where they no longer depended on God. And it's in their lack of dependence and their increase in their self-reliance that this kingdom has allowed idolatry and idolatry worship and this deafening tone to injustice, what was going on in their nation. Now, Amos, being led by God, went up and said, "Hey, guys, there's something not right about what's going on here, how the kingdom is being run. And I'm here to say that God's judgment is coming." He's blowing that horn. He's saying it's coming. And what was God not okay with? Well, when we look at the passage, we're going to see that he's not okay with two things that are happening here. One was their inauthentic worship, and two, the mistreatment of the vulnerable in their society. Pick up with me in Amos chapter 5, starting at verse 5. It says this, "But do not seek Bethel, and do not enter into Gilgal, or cross over to Beersheba. For Gilgal shall surely go into exile, and Bethel shall come to nothing. Seek the Lord and live, lest he break out like fire in the house of Joseph, and it devour, with none to quench it for Bethel. O you who turn justice to wormwood and cast down righteousness to the earth." The people are seeking God through religion. These areas that Amos mentioned are popular places of worship. And what we see in verse 21 is that these people knew how to have church. They knew how to have church. They had these great feasts and festivals and music. And what we see is that in their knowing to have church, they're forgetting some things. You see, in their worship, the people of Israel were simply going through the motions. They were going through the motions of worship without actually seeking the Lord in their worship. And we can readily identify with these people, right? Many of us go through great lengths to try to get the Lord's attention, to earn his approval in some of the things that we do, whether it be coming to church, whether it be, you know, stepping out and putting others above ourselves, right? We go to church regularly. We give the right amount of tithe, and we do these things to feel good about ourselves, yet our hearts aren't in the right place. And God says, "Guys, seek me and live." In the midst of all their religious activity, they miss the beauty of God and who he is. And he keeps going by pointing out their mistreatment of the most vulnerable in their society. Look at verse 10 of chapter 5. It says, "They hate him who reproves in the gate." Now, when you read "in the gate," that means the place of law and justice in the city. So let's keep reading. "They hate him who reproves in the gate, and they abhor him who speaks the truth. Therefore, because you trample on the poor and you exact taxes of grain from him, you have built houses of hewn stone, but you shall not dwell in them. You have planted pleasant vineyards, but you shall not drink their wine. For I know how many are your transgressions and how great are your sins, you who afflict the righteous, who take a bribe and turn aside the needy in the gate." Now catch this with me. They went through all the religious observance that we were just talking about, and yet their hearts weren't altered. In fact, instead of desiring righteousness and justice for everyone in their society, they cared only about themselves. What has been happening is that the rich people of the day, they've built all these different things for themselves, these mansions, these pleasures. And they did all those things, and they wanted it to benefit in for themselves in this materialistic way of living. They did these things, and then the poor and the vulnerable would be the ones who would suffer because of it. They stepped on and they looked over those individuals, and in the process of doing that, they taxed those individuals differently than those who were in power. Instead of being the people of God and caring for those individuals, they ostracized them. They mistreated them. So what we see is that Amos is telling them that the Lord is going to sweep through them because of this. He's saying that the train is coming. Judgment is coming. Remember their worship services that were amazing? Look again at verse 20. Look at 21. He says, I despise your feasts, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And the peace offerings of your fattened animals, I will not look upon them. Take away from me the noise of your songs, to the melody of your harps, I will not listen. In this moment, God is telling them, I don't want your songs. I don't want them. I don't want your feasts. I don't want any of that. What I want you to do is to seek me and to live. And in seeking me, your worship changes from being focused on you and your celebrations, from shifting to me and who I am. When you begin to focus on me and who I am, your concern shifts from your own self-interest to the interests of others. What does that look like? Verse 24, let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Family, God does not simply just want music and offerings and festivals for the sake of having them. Worship in the eyes of God consists of justice and righteousness. What we see with Israel and what we need to be reminded of today is that rituals can become barriers to righteousness. I'll say that again. Rituals, the things that we do, the things that we pride ourselves in moving forward in, can become the very things that are blocking us from righteousness. This is what Amos is saying to Israel, and this is what we must be mindful of as well. Now, I don't mean to insult your intelligence, but I feel like it's necessary to walk through these two words to get the whole scope of what I mean. And those two words, righteousness and justice. Righteousness is described here in the Hebrew as this standard of right relationship towards people, no matter their social differences. And justice is described as concrete actions taken to correct injustice in order to create righteousness. You see, God's idea of justice was treating the poor and the needy well. He is calling out a system that works to keep the poor people poor and allows the rich to keep getting rich at the expense of those who are poor. God says that this is unjust. So Amos says to them in verse 15, establish justice in the gate. You see, Jesus too was equally concerned about justice and treating people well. He talked about how we spend our money and how we care for those in need. In fact, in Matthew 25, verse 35 through 36, it says this, I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. What Jesus is saying here is that the way you can tell that you have a real experience with grace is that you see people in need and you pour out your heart for them. You pour out your heart for them. Guys, if the church supports a system that neglects justice and righteousness, and we simply just turn a blind eye to injustice that we see on the news and in our towns, and we aren't calling it out while it continues to happen, while at the same time we come to church on Sunday as if nothing is going on, God is saying, you are not in line with who I am and where my heart is, and I don't want to hear it. Hear this. A failure to show concern for the poor and the vulnerable, it shows a misunderstanding of the gospel. And what I mean by that is we have never realized our own pressing need of God's merciful attention to us in our sin. We are needy people. We are needy people and we need rescue. We need a savior. That's the premise of the gospel, that Jesus stepped in into our need. Charlie Dates, a current pastor in Chicago, he says this: every pious outburst of refined biblical exegesis without a corresponding social and cultural compassion for those who live on the margin is a failure of a feigned devotion and a false exegetical practice. Those are fancy words to essentially say, if you have never woken up to injustice, never been moved by compassion, if you're not generous with what God has given you with your resources you have, it begs the question of whether you have encountered the real gospel for yourself. The gospel that saves, the gospel that transforms, the gospel that propels us into mission to others. You know, I wonder if God looks at us in our times of worship and our times of singing, our times of interaction, and if he's saying, I'm tired of your noise too. If I'm honest with you guys, when I begin to think about injustice in our society, I have to be honest. I get overwhelmed. There's abortion on demand. There's racial injustice and systemic racism. There's law practices that benefit those in positions of power while belittling those who don't have it. And all of that is just on a Monday morning. As soon as you address one topic, another one pops up. And again, if I can be honest with you, I like to avoid pain. I don't want to step into it. And on top of that, I often think, well, I'm just one person. What in the world can I do? These thoughts and questions come naturally to us. But if we aren't careful, it can lead to apathy. This apathy, it's has created a Christianity that's comfortable, that's easy to navigate, and allows us to put the blinders on to simply say, well, all things will be good in the sweet by and by. When Jesus comes back, Lord, come save us from this wretched place, right? You want to know who else operated like that? The nation of Israel. Look with me at verse 18. He says, woe to you who desire the day of the Lord. Why would you have the day of the Lord? It is darkness and not light. The children of Israel, the nation of Israel, they could not wait for the day of the Lord. They talked about how much they desired for God to come and to deliver them from all of their brokenness, to save them from their enemies. But they had an incorrect understanding of that day. It was a bad day. Amos was like, nah, fam, you don't want that day. Trust me. You see, Amos refers to the day of the Lord 5 times in the book of Amos, and it's always a day of judgment. Israel assumed that judgment was coming for those on the outside, but God is saying, nah, it's coming for you. The horn is blowing. Guys, I cannot stress enough how hard this passage is. You have the people of God essentially turning from God in their actions, and then you see the judgment of God lining up against them. They're in the crosshairs. Yet it's in this that we still see the heart of God for his people. Three times in this chapter, in the midst of all this, he's calling them to still seek him and live. Believe it or not, I love the prophets in the Old Testament. With all the gloom and doom and everything else, I love the prophets because as hard as these passages are, they offer us hope. The day of the Lord and the minor prophets, as I just mentioned, it talks about coming judgment. The judgment is coming. However, for you and I in present day, when we think about coming judgment, we need to understand that it began with the crucifixion of Jesus. You see, there the judgment that we feared and we rightly deserved was poured out on Christ. In the face of coming judgment, God is still extending an offer of grace, an offer of repentance to those that he loves. And what does that offer? To seek him and live. And when we do that, family, we can find safety. But seeking him and living, it looks a little bit differently than what we may assume. starts with this. When we seek Him and live, our worship changes. As we saw in verses 5 and 7, the people are seeking God through religion. Those popular places of worship that had all the festivals, that they offered all the sacrifices, that God saw down to the root of the matter. It was all for show. It was all for them. Have you been guilty of that? You know, I grew up in the South, and there's this way of thinking that I know permeates the doors of the church. The type of thinking that says don't smoke, drink, or chew, or hang with people that do. You know what I'm saying? You ever heard that? That as long as I'm not as bad as those people over there, well, then I'm okay. Listen, refusing to repent of sins will be the thing that keeps us from seeing Jesus face to face. But I also believe that moral religion is just as damning. This is what I mean by that. You know what makes me nervous? Passages like Matthew 7, 21 through 23. It's a passage that describes people who are doing things in the name of the Lord, and yet He says to them, "Depart from me, that I never knew you." It's the people, as Matthew 15 says, that honor God with their lips, but their hearts are far from Him. Family, we must understand that there is a difference between seeking religion and seeking after the Lord. There's a difference between simply singing songs and having those songs change our posture and draws us closer to Jesus. There's a difference between hearing the words of a sermon and actually having those words pierce our hearts and draw us closer to God in obedience. There is no security in listening to sermons. There is no security in coming to church. There is no security in playing K-Love on your radio. Security is in seeking after and resting in Jesus. It doesn't end there, though. Seeking Him means that we will many times be corrected. Look again at verse 10. It says, "They hate Him who reproves in the gate. They abhor Him who speaks the truth." What's that saying? Is Amos was despised. He was hated for calling out injustice and for speaking the truth where nobody else did. Question. Are we guilty of doing the same for those who are calling out blind spots in our lives? See, oftentimes when the conversation of justice comes up, we get frustrated or angry that this conversation is littered with some sort of political agenda. Now, have people hijacked this conversation for their own benefit politically? Yes, of course. But have we grown dismissive to the conversation simply because we just don't want to be corrected? Probably so. You see, our comforts are being poked at and taken from us that we find ourselves exposed. Listen, if we're to seek God and live, that means letting go of our idols and our incorrect ways of thinking. That means that those blind spots that have been exposed, we must humbly learn to grow out of those based off what Scripture says. Verses 8 and 9 speaks about the majesty and the greatness of God and how He is over and above every single way. So when we see something or when we hear something based off what Scripture says, who are we to dispute it? When we begin to look through these things through the lenses of Scripture, it begins to change how we operate. This is what I mean by that. We've allowed our politics to define how we see the world instead of allowing Scripture to do the defining for us. And if that's true, we must repent. I'll use an example. Over the past several years, we've seen this statement more than once. The statement that Black Lives Matter. Man, I don't know if I've seen a more triggering or polarizing statement than those three words right there. Listen, as Christians, there's things about that organization that it makes sense for us to tread lightly and to tread with extreme caution. However, the statement Black Lives Matter in and of itself is biblical, not political. And I truly believe that if the church was operating in the way that it's supposed to be, that the organization wouldn't exist at all. Listen, according to Genesis 1, all lives were created in the image of God. And for that reason, they matter. What we need to understand, though, is that that statement of Black Lives Matter does not mean that other lives do not. But historically, in our American context, it would appear that Black lives do not equal to the level of our counterparts. And for those of us who walk with Jesus, when lives are mistreated, that should frustrate us. That should break our hearts. And if it doesn't, then family, we should stand corrected. This is an issue of biblical justice. And if it's bothered you in the past few minutes of me even talking about it, then chances are you need to go back and look at verse 10 and ask yourself the question, why? Here is how we should live. We let Scripture dictate how we think. We look through these things through the lens of Scripture, how we believe, how we operate. And when Scripture is calling us out, guys, we repent. We go the direction that Scripture is calling us into. But finally, seeking Him means doing what is good and not evil. Verse 14 says this, seek good and not evil, that you may live. And so the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you as you have said. Verse 15, hate evil and love good, and establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. Now I want to make sure that you hear me say this. You are saved by grace alone, and praise God for it. You're not saved by your works. You're not saved by doing good things versus not doing those bad things. We cannot claim to be the people of God and then engage in ungodly living, right? Seeking the Lord means that we hate evil and love good. We cannot love evil, but then say that we love God too. Last weekend, when I was with you guys, I shared with you about holiness, right? The positional and the practical. We're holy because God says that we are. But that doesn't just give us license to sin. We must be holy on that practical level as well, living this out daily. And here's what I'm getting at. We cannot be people that simply excuse ourselves with grace. Do we continue sin so that grace may keep on going? Paul said, nope. Don't you dare do that. We have to die to sin daily. And if we have really been forgiven, we will have our hearts and our desires changed to love good and not evil. You know, I had someone tell me a long time ago that you can tell that you're walking with Jesus when you are fighting your sin daily. The issue comes up when your sin doesn't bother you anymore and you dive headfirst into it. And that's when we need to be concerned. So, what do we do with all of this? I don't want you to leave from here turning off your computer or your TV feeling frustrated, because after hearing something like this, it can cause guilt or apathy or frustration. I believe it starts with seeking the Lord. Guys, you must ask the Lord to seek your heart in this area. It's not enough to just have these things searched out, but to then repent of them. What have I been worshiping lately? Where have I been worshiping falsely lately? Where do I buck at correction? Where do I prefer evil over good? When you begin to see these things, give them to God and have Him forgive you. Have Him transform you. Have Him give you a desire to pursue good over evil. Seek Him. Oftentimes, we're ignorant of what's going on in our hearts and our minds. However, when that ignorance is seen, we cannot use it for innocence any longer. God is saying, seek me and live. It's when we seek Him that our hearts begin to soften and our eyes are open to what's going on around us. In the same way that He knew about our sin and pursued us, we then pursue others in love and we care for them as God cares for them. Why? Because this is what He desires. This is what He wants of us. This is what I'm praying for Proclamation Church. We have intentionally targeted one of the most unchurched areas in this city. If you look at a map of Nashville, that southern corridor is one of the most unchurched areas. It has one of the highest unemployment rates in the city and in the entire state. Our area is nestled right between two major highways, Highway 24 and Highway 40. And right here in this pocket, it's known for heavy drug trafficking and sex trafficking because of those two highways intersecting. And this is where we have decided to place our lives, to do the work of ministry. Because as I said last week, we want to be a people that proclaim the excellencies of Christ Jesus. And it's here in this area that people need to see what it looks like to be called out of darkness and to experience the marvelous and beautiful and glorious light of grace found in Jesus Christ. The reality is we know that it's not going to be easy, but we believe that God desires for people to follow him and to make him known. Jesus came to seek justice for us personally, and now we're going out to others because he came for us. So what will you do? What will you do? Maybe here in this moment, some of you have never even thought about the conversation of justice and righteousness in your particular context. And if that's the case, maybe it's time you start to educate yourself a little bit. Maybe it's time to begin to not only think about your particular city and your particular area, but our history as well, and what's been going on and how it's still plaguing a lot of what we see in education, in our healthcare, and different things like that. Maybe God is calling you to come and be a part of the work that we're trying to do here in Nashville. Support the work through prayer. Maybe it begins to champion those who don't have a voice. Whatever it is that you're doing, you need to understand that you are not alone in it. That one of the last things that Jesus said to his disciples is that he is going to be with us. And that's encouraging because, as I said earlier, that this work of justice, this work of seeing people flourish, it's hard, it's challenging, and we cannot do it in our own strength, but we have the strength of Jesus who is going with us. That's my prayer for us here. And family, that's my prayer for you as well. As you begin to live out what it means to seek God and live in your own life. Let me pray. God, you're good. And this is such a heavy word in our current cultural climate. But Lord God, I pray that you would do the work of surgery here, that you would cut with a scalpel. Because it's in the scalpel as you're cutting that healing comes. Father, a lot of times people have stepped into this conversation and they've been stabbed. They're scared, they're nervous, they don't want to take part in it. But God, I pray that they would see that this is a part of your heart. That as they look through not just Amos, but all of the Old Testament and how there was a lot of injustice that was taking place. But God, you care. And because you do, we should as well. Father, I pray that through the power of your Holy Spirit, that you would empower us to seek you and live, that we would seek justice, that we would seek righteousness. Lord God, we know that, again, this is on your heart. So help us to have the heart of God in it. We can't do this without you. We love you. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word. a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation. You did not despise the cross, for even in your suffering you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now the sky's
You know, I'm pretty sure the prophet Amos hasn't attended Woodman. You know, he's been gone for a while. But I think he would like our vision statement to love well, change lives through Christ. And the thing about loving well, to wanting to see lives changed, isn't just to see lives changed for eternity, but to have impact on lives today. And in this contentious season, we want to be the men and women of God who stand for what's right and seek to bring change through the power of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the lives of those he puts in front of us. This is a trying time in a lot of ways, but an exciting time too, to see what God is going to do and that we get to be a part of it. So I am so excited about these weeks we've had with Pastor Derek, what God is doing here in Tennessee, what God is doing in and through you. As you go, go with this. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. See you soon.